black too. I come from the trenches. You know, I come from the dirt. And I fought my way out, and I fought to be in this position. And so he's going to eat his words. So if I can explain him in one word, hater.
Best of luck to you, Jacobs. Thank you.
Thank you.
Matt next, please.
Matt from behind the gloves. I'd just like to know, you've mentioned a few times you want to make him eat his words. Now, does that mean that you have to win this fight by knockout to be satisfied?
No, I mean, I just want to beat him up. You know, I just want to hear when I hit him with a body shot, him cringe, or, I mean, we know he's a bleeder, so I look forward to, you know, his trunks being stained, my trunks being stained full of his blood, and I'm going to hang it up somewhere in my house with a plaque. You know, that's going to make me satisfied because I know the pain that I'm going to put this man through because of some of the hateful things that he said for me throughout the years. And so this is the only way a fighter could get that revenge. This is the only way two men who are boxers get there and settle their debts.
Just one more from me. Providing you do get the win on Friday night, what's your ideal scenario? Is it the winner of, say, Canelo and Smith? Where do you want to go? If you could choose, what's the route?
Well, I mean, if I can choose, man, it's just anybody with a belt. I just want to go. I just want to be a two-time world champion. You know, I have the team. Keith Conley's my manager. You know, he's the best manager in the game. I assure you that I'm going to set myself up in a position to get an opportunity to fight for a belt. And the landscape of the super middleweight division is amazing. I think that, you know, winner or loser of the Calvin Smith fight is an opportunity. Billy Joe Saunders is an opportunity. I've been calling out, you know, Jamal Charlo for years now. So these are all fights that could be made. And I look forward for my team to make the right decisions for me. At the same time, we have options. And that's the beautiful thing about this situation.
Cheers and good luck Friday, Dylan.
Thank you.
YSM, please.
Hi, Danny. How's it going?
Good, thank you.
What skills or abilities does Gabriel Rosado possess that could possibly make this a difficult fight?
You're making me think on this one. I mean, boxing is a very unpredictable sport, and there's been times that I've actually went into a fight thinking that one fighter was going to offer something different, or, you know, something what I'm used to or what we trained for from his past fights, and then he gave me a completely different fight. And so, you know, you always just have to be professional and you have to adjust. And so if there's a situation in this fight where I need to adjust, I think I'll do just that. But I don't know if I'll see a different Gabe Rosado. You know, I know he says he has Freddie Roach in his corner, and he vows that he's going to do things differently like he hasn't been doing before. I mean, I don't know. I don't know if it's that easy to change your whole style or to teach your old dog new tricks. I really don't know. And it's not like, you know, you cannot polish. You maybe be a little bit more polished, but I feel like we've seen the best Gabe Rosado. But as a professional, I think it's my job to train and be ready for anything. And that's where the respect lies. Me training 100% to be ready for whatever Gabe Rosado shows up.
Thanks, Danny. I appreciate it.
Thank you. It takes the stress off of not, you know, focusing 100% solely on the fight. And when you're training for a fighter, especially at this level, we're at a level where we have to be extremely focused for the fight. You can't slack. You can't, you know, be unfocused. You have to go in there with a clear mind. And I think the fact that 85% of my camps have been based off of just training to lose the weight, now we're at a position to where we don't really have to focus on the losing weight part. We can focus on polishing up our skills, specifically training for a fighter and their bad habits to be successful. And I think we're doing just that. So, yes, I'm a little bit more vibrant. I'm definitely able to take a lot more water and food. You know, it's unheard of for me to even eat on the weigh-in or the day before the weigh-in, which I look forward to, and, you know, for the rest of my career. Depleted, I don't think you can give that extra hump that you need to when it's time to get down and dirty and gritty. I think in order to bring out the dog and the fighter, if you need to, you need to be able to have the nutrition to be able to properly go out and give it a good go. So for me, not knowing, or not that it's not knowing,
appreciate it.
Thank you.
Danny, good morning. Gail Falkenthal, apologies for the dog. She gets excited when she hears champions talk. She is a boxer.
That's awesome.
She is the boxer after all, so that's her thing. I believe this has been the longest layoff of your pro career. Is that correct? I mean, by just a little bit.
My manager's right here. Is this the longest layoff that we had? Except for the cancer that I had, but yeah.
Right, aside from that. Yeah, so.
Sure.
And you've had to cope with pandemic conditions all that time. Yeah. So how have you stayed in shape, kept focused, prepared, and are you at all concerned about any ring rust?
Well, yeah, I'm not going to lie. 100%. I am worried a little bit about ring rust because obviously during this pandemic, me being based in Atlanta, the cases were really, really spiking high. And it was a worry to even come outside. So the first half of the pandemic, I didn't really get the best training. I made training camp in my home and did the best that I can do on my own. But obviously you need a training team to be able to give the proper boxing training. And so we didn't get that to, you know, I would probably say the second half. And then we made sure that we had 11, 12 week of camp so we can try to get the rust out. But, you know, you never know until you actually go inside the ring and you perform. So I think Gabe Rosado was the perfect fighter to fight coming out of this pandemic. I mean, no excuses for me. I know I have to still go in there and be professional and look my best and give it my best. But at the same time, you know, the world affects a fighter, especially in these conditions, and you have to be realistic. And, you know, kudos to all the fighters out there who are going through this pandemic and taking fights and still, you know, giving it their best. You know, I respect all of them, and I respect everyone who puts their pair of gloves on and risks their lives. But, you know, my situation is a little bit different. You know, I really didn't have the best training that I could possibly have, but I'm 100% confident in the 11, 12-week camp that I had leading up into this camp, and it's been one of the best camps that I've had. And so we took every proper precaution to where we didn't get, you know, COVID, or we stayed away from potential threats, or just in general, you know, we made sure we was precautious. And so I look forward to coming and Friday night being victorious.
Good luck to you. Thanks so much for giving up your Thanksgiving weekend for us.
Yeah, that's awesome. I'm very grateful for that. Thank you.
Hey, Danny, Johnny, Pro Boxing fans. One more question I had. We've obviously mentioned potential future fights with Billy Joe Saunders, Callum Smith. With Callum Smith facing Canelo, what do you think he has to do to beat Canelo, and what have you learned from that defeat that you're taking into Friday night?
What I've learned from that fight that I'm taking into Friday night, I've already done, and that's move up to the super middleweight division. I think I wasn't able to be my 100% self or be able to give it the best go that I could because of the weight clause and the weight restrictions that I had on top of already having a hard time with making the middleweight division. Now that I'm extremely fit, I don't have weight as an issue anymore. I'm super hydrated and, you know, I only have the fight to worry about. I think it's going to be different every time out, you know, from my performances, you're going to see a different Danny Jacobs. And, you know, people even predicted that me moving up and fighting Chavez, you know, that I wasn't going to be the same because of my past performances. You know, Mark can tell you, you know, there was a lot of people who predicted that Chavez was going to beat me. But at the same time, I knew that there is a certain level of fighter that lives within me that if I'm 100% with no restrictions on me, that I can be at my very best and I can give it a good go. And you've seen what Chavez quit on the stool. So I'm excited to be able to continue my performances like that, but continue to be better. I have a new trainer now, Fariz Tamad. This is our third fight together. And he's the OG of the game. So, you know, he's a former fighter as well. He trained the Army team on USA Boxing. So he's very knowledgeable of the game. And so we've come up with a great, not only plan for boxing, but during my off days too, or during my time where I'm not actually boxing, he comes to Atlanta, we train together. So he's a very active trainer. And I think that's key and critical for me at this point in my career to be able to have a trainer that's so heavily involved in me and heavily into my training and, you know, just my techniques and the skill set. But I know I'm going overboard with it, but at the same time, it's what does Caleb have to do? I just think he has to create a great game plan in order to beat Canelo. He has a lot of advantages, but the main disadvantage is probably the experience. And so sometimes fighters who are in a new situation to where the lights, the camera, the action is on them, sometimes they fold. And so we never know, and I can't give a prediction, but I just have to say, in order for Caleb to be successful, he would have to use his strengths and cater to his strengths. And I think, you know, it would be an interesting fight, but I can't predict the winner. So,
cheers, Danny. Best of luck.
Thank you.
Thanks very much, guys. That's Danny's time over and done with. He actually did a little bit more, but that's probably because he's the nicest man in boxing. Thank you very much, champ. Nice. And everybody, thanks for your time with Danny. We'll bring in Emmanuel Tago now.
So Danny Jacobs, Rosado. Danny Jacobs, I was told it looks like Will Smith, he is out.
You guys can you hear us okay?
Yeah, there you are. Thank you, Peter. Thanks for joining us. Obviously, Peter Khan, Emmanuel's manager, is with us as well. So, guys, hands up for any questions for Emmanuel. But first of all, Peter, you're bouncing from bubble to bubble with Matchroom, right?
Absolutely. Listen, I was in the London bubble with George Kambosos, I guess maybe a month ago for the Selby fight. I got to tell you, you guys have the best bubbles, I think, and the best food so far. So...
Well, yeah, they're not too bad. The London one's nice and plush, I'll tell you that. Yeah. But obviously, that was a really great win for George, and you know, it's a win
George
in a division that is so vibrant right now. Teofimo Lopez has kind of just blown the whole thing apart. You know, obviously, our charge, Devin Haney's right there. We've got Campbell Garcia coming up. But where does Emmanuel fit into the scene?
Emmanuel is the best kept secret in the lightweight division. A lot of people just haven't seen him fight yet, so they don't know what to make of it. They just see a guy that's highly rated, but they really don't know who he is. We know who he is. That's why we're so excited about Emmanuel. And in advance of the Selby fight, Emmanuel sparred, in excess of 50, 60 rounds with George?
Yeah.
And so, I mean, very competitive. You know, excellent work. He's awkward. He's just got a unique style. And I mean, look, you guys will see him on Friday night.
Great stuff. Thanks, Peter. Thanks for that intro there. Gail with the first question, please. Hello, Gail.
Apologies, folks. We got in quick. Being in the bubble all this year and having fought multiple times in the bubble, do you think it gives you perhaps a bit of an advantage?
So this is Emmanuel's first time fighting in the bubble. He had been off. He was supposed to fight in March, but this is his first experience. I mean, as a team, we've had experience in different bubbles, whether it's been Top Rank or Matchroom. But for Emmanuel, it's his first fight back since... Really, it's been a while.
But for the team, you know how to manage this. I mean, this is not a small undertaking.
Right. So yeah.
You've been able to get these guys through it. What does it take?
You know, look, I would love to tell you that it's been difficult, but I think it's actually been, in a way, it's been great because it just keeps everybody very focused. So, you know, less distractions. Look, I'm sensitive to COVID, obviously, but it kind of keeps things really tight, really close. I think, you know, preparing them for fighting without an audience has been the biggest thing, you know, feeling like they're going into almost like a gym environment, a very sterile kind of cold environment with no crowd. But everybody's, you know, been mentally prepared for that. And you know, we've just conveyed the experiences we've had with the different fighters that we've worked with, and the other fighters have come back to camp and expressed those same things. So right now, I mean, we've had nothing but positive experiences.
Emmanuel, do you feel mentally prepared, since the actual training is probably not too different once your gym is safe? But how's that mental preparation been for you?
Yeah,
First of all, like, I want to thank Almighty God. After that, I want to thank... good opportunity for me. I will showcase myself to everybody and will say, 135, I'm the best, because I'm the best in secret. By now, I've come out.
Thank you very much. Good luck to you.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Corner man next, please.
Good afternoon, gentlemen. So, Tago, your camp is calling you the best kept secret. You come from Accra, Ghana, which has been home to many world champions. What do you want the world to find out about you Friday night? And how do you feel you will compete against some of the current champions in the lightweight division?
Yes, Friday night, everybody can feel happy because, you know, Emmanuel Tego, my nickname is Game Boy. If you come or if you watch, you clap yourself to round one, to any round, I can stop. I can decide to stop my opponent. Maybe if I see my opponent Thursday, I tell everybody, say I stop my opponent, maybe round one or two or three. By now, I can't decide. But I promise all of you, I do my best. I do my best. You like, you are fun.
So there you have it. Another great video for ES News. For ESNewsReporting.com, I'm Elie Seckbach reporting. And you can follow me on Twitter, at Seckbach. And you can follow me on Instagram at Elie Seckbach.